Okay. So to continue, we come to actually the last lecture of this winter school, and now we go towards, again, as I said this morning, population analysis. And nowadays, as you know, machine learning is very, very popular, especially deep learning with all the Google, Apples and Facebooks of this world. And everybody is trying to apply it. And you see in medicine, there really is a boom. If you currently look actually at the cardiac literature and you look at all the big journals, you see that almost in every issue, currently there's something in machine learning. And so now groups are kind of starting to try things out. Also, since a lot of the software is available for researchers, they say like, okay, give me data and I'll give you some results. Of course, as we saw before, things are not that easy. And so in a way, in our research team, we also started with this. It's like, let's try to do some machine learning. And we hired a PhD student, Sergio, in order to do that. And then you quickly see also that one of the things is, okay, the technological part is one thing, and there are tools available, and you can use this on data. But what is actually, to me, much, much more important is what do you do with these results? It's very nice that you get a picture in Google or on Facebook and it says it's a dog and a chair and this and that. But since diagnosis is not that easy, what you need to do is, okay, you can suggest something using machine learning or using computers, but you need to be able to interpret it and you need to be able to link it back to knowledge of the cardiologist, to whatever is current clinical practice, as we say, the art of medicine in the previous talk. But I think also towards what we know about physiology, for example, because if you have data, you get results, they have to be meaningful. It cannot be that you say, okay, this is a label sick or healthy, and maybe it could be all right for classifying some things, but you don't learn from it, and sometimes it doesn't help an individual patient, because we learn by now that one individual decision, one individual parameter, one individual aspect is never enough. And so for that, we started to work a little bit in trying to see what can we get additionally out of imaging, or how can we use imaging data in order to look at that. And that's actually what Sergio is going to talk about us. And one of the things there that you can see is that in medicine, even if you'd say it as the art of medicine, is in a way recognizing patterns, but patterns based on all the information that you have and everything that you learned from the past. And I think this is the way forward. And I'm very happy that Sergio is here. He's one of the PhD students in Barcelona, which is working on this. And he can also give you the perspective of now trying to apply this in clinical practice and trying to discuss with cardiologists what to do with it. And then also trying to explain what this is about for different publics. So please, Sergio.
Thank you very much. And thank you, Bart and Matt, for offering me the opportunity to give this talk. Bart has very nicely introduced me already, and I think I can skip some of the first slides where I have my background. But this is like, what I'm doing is machine learning, as Bart said. It's not to get better features from images like we were discussing the first day with vector flow imaging, where you want to do machine learning probably to get better features of the hemodynamics or probably cardiac mechanical function, or you don't want to do machine learning to improve segmentation. But what I'm doing actually is, yeah, to really study populations and see if we can identify different patterns of disease in populations combining a different set of descriptors. So just a bit about myself, although Bart already said, but I'm a third year PhD student at the Universitat Pompeu Fabra in Barcelona. With a background in telecommunication engineering and a master in biomedical engineering. I'm part of these two groups. The people, it's seems very, very happy. We are serious people doing serious research, but and these two groups, as you can say, both of them are in the same place. We are not very original taking pictures there. So this is the terrace of our department, and this is a bit the area where we are. So I'm partly working with Symbiosis, which they do simulation imaging and modeling for biological systems. And I'm also part of the group that Bart is leading. It's called Physons, and they are doing computational physiology, computational geometry, systems medicine. In the end, it's just to find this balance between engineering and the clinical applications. My supervisors are Nicolas Duchateau, who was he did his PhD at UPF in Barcelona, then he stayed in a hospital clinic, then he moved to INRIA, Sophia Antipolis, And now he is, he got a permanent position in the Universitat de Lyon, in the Creatis group, where, like some of people here. Then Gemma Piella is professor at UPF as well, and Bart Bynes, that you already know him very good. And also I'm funded by the private banking foundation. It's like I said, they are giving PhD, they are funding 25 PhDs each year to do a PhD in Spain. And nice thing of this scholarship is that they are paying paying you to do 6 months abroad of a research stay. So I did already 3 months at INRIA Sophia Antipolis in the Asclepios team. And now in a month I'm going to the Brigham and Women's Hospital to work actually to apply these machine learning techniques on the very big data sets that they have, because they are managing some of the big clinical trials in the States for heart failure, CRT devices, and so on. So the idea is that I'll go there in 1 month just to start to look at their data. And now cardiovascular diseases, as you are all here because of the same reason studying cardiovascular diseases, because they are a major cause of death, morbidity, and loss of quality of life. But they are also, they are complex entities actually, and they are characterized by a presence of intricate cause-effect interactions that are actually difficult to identify. Just to give a couple of examples, for example, a local myocardial infarct, it normally presents a region which is normally thinner, and that presents deformation abnormalities, actually almost no deformation. But then there is a global impact in the function of the heart, like you'll see globally dilated cavities, and for example, a thicker wall in the vicinity of the infarct, because if the infarcted region is not working, then the neighbor regions have to compensate this dysfunction. So in the end, it's like you have something local, but it's globally affecting your heart, and you really need to look at the whole picture of the heart to understand what's going on. And for example, just another example, this is a congenital anomaly, Abstain's anomaly, where this will be a normal heart, and this will be the heart of an Abstain's, of a subject having Abstain's anomaly, where the in the right heart, the tricuspid valve is quite displaced towards the apex. And normally it has been described as a problem of the right heart, so there will be a dysfunction in the right heart. But also what we were looking now, we were looking at, yeah, thank you. We were looking actually at the function of the left heart, and we were starting to see also differences. So probably what has been reported, it was just for the right heart, but if you look again at the heart as a whole, and you see different things at different locations, you will see that there are also things going on there. And then just to comment a bit on clinical diagnosis, it relies on the expertise of cardiologists, who normally are trained after many years of practice, and they really identify different patterns watching images and really identifying different different diseases. And in the end, they integrate this visual recognition with other, let's say, simple markers of disease that could be like demographics, like age, race, sex, cardiac structure, size, volume, or mass, or function. And then they are really integrated what they see on the images with these biomarkers, then to take a decision. And probably some of the classical approaches to see and to analyze these markers of disease could be like multiparametric regression models, where they in the end want to predict, respond to therapy or outcome. And also in the way they normally will look at these markers will be with a decision tree that it giving you a heart split, so a binary diagnosis like healthy or diseased without any learning involved. But the problem is that, of course, the induced changes with pathology are more complex in both domains, the temporal domain, because the cardiac function, if you see at different phases like systole, diastole, there can probably be differences in normal population of, or disease subjects. But also in the spatial function, hemodynamics, mechanical function, and so on. And well, and in the end, what they do to, end to a standard diagnosis is they, from experience, they either based on clinical evidence, as Alan was mentioning, or based on consensus raising hands, they have these clinical guidelines that sometimes, especially with complex diseases, can be an oversimplification of what's going on. And it leads to, of course, of a lack of understanding of the pathophysiology. And then, of course, suboptimal prediction or diagnosis. And if the diagnosis is suboptimal, the treatment that you will apply is probably ineffective. And now to talk a bit about, because of course the clinicians are not wrong, they just probably need to interact also with us, with these machine learning algorithms, just to put what they know already about the diseases and see if we can do something more about not just using decision trees or things like that, but probably exploring the data in a more objective way. And if we think about the learning process of clinicians, they normally learn by experience after many years of training. And they normally do a progressive and hierarchical reading of their data. So if I think 2 days ago we were discussing an athlete in the clinical hands-on, and we were looking at the echo images of this athlete, and the first thing we were looking, it was the four-chamber view. And we were starting to comment what was abnormal in this subject, and probably it was like we had like thicker walls, we had a bit dilated cavities. So after that, we were going probably to assess, because we know that the athletes probably have a dysfunction in the right ventricle, so we were looking at the tricuspid flow, or we were like going from the general picture to something that it's more focused. Of course, with all this information that they were getting with this hierarchical reading, they then contextualize. So if they know that this guy was an athlete presenting these features, this is probably normal in an athlete, so it's not problematic. And then they iterate on that and they to refine and in the end confirm the diagnosis. But how can we help actually? Because this is probably a very good approach, but in the end, how can we help with an algorithmic approach to improve a bit the diagnosis in the end? So in the end, algorithmic approaches offers us a quantitative and objective approach where we have large amounts of data. These algorithmic approaches are fast and reproducible. They are objective, they are fast and reproducible. They allows you to not just looking at scalar values like ejection fraction or QRF width or NIHA class or whatever to discriminate different populations, for example, with heart failure, but they really allows you to integrate complex and very diverse variables like images or patterns or whatever, so like very complex descriptors. And in the end, they allow you to find also interactions between these descriptors, which is something that it's sometimes, especially with complex diseases, is not obvious if you have something that in the end is affecting, as we were discussing, for example, for infarct. You have something that affects other things, but probably this is not, you cannot visually see it or you cannot even identify. So with this kind of analysis, also you can identify these kind of interactions. So in the end, what you want to do is, with these algorithms, you want to look at this complex data, but in the end, as this is very complex, you want to find a way to represent this in an easy way. So a representation that is low dimensional, so you can see, like for example, in a 2D or 3D space, your population and the distribution of your population actually, and this allows more efficient analysis because you can really compare one subject to the other and see what is the distance of a normal subject to a diseased subject or and so on. The way classical statistics work is normally everything is told from the data, from the population. So if you do mean values or quartiles on different parameters, you will have a picture of your population. But what machine learning is doing, it's they have the ability to learn from data without being programmed to do so. So you have an input, you have an output, you have something in the middle that is a mathematical expression that is relating the input with the output, but you don't know this expression beforehand, but you want to learn actually this expression. So a well-posed learning algorithm will be like you have something you want to learn from experience, as clinicians are doing. You are seeing a lot of data. You, of course, you have some tasks that you predefine looking at your data. So it can be classification, it can be segmentation or registration, it can be regression, so learning on your population and what's the distribution of your population. And then, of course, you need some performance measurement that it's telling you if your algorithm is improving or not. And in the end, you are learning if the performance on the task as measured by the performance measurement P improves with experience, indeed. And then, so what do we need for that? So if we want to learn from experience, we need large amounts of data. If we, with respect to the task that we really have to define, if we want to do classification, or we want to do regression, or we want to improve segmentation, this is the task to define, and of course then define the measure. For example, I don't know, for classification, you will measure the agreement with previous knowledge. For regression, you will look at correlation with clinical variables, and so on. So this is a bit the whole idea. But then be cautious, because machine learning, it's no magic. The machine that you are using has no brain, and you really need to carefully define your task. What is the metric that you are going to use to improve your task? And in the end, think of an optimization and where to stop, indeed, because this next slide is talking a bit about this. So you are optimizing your task and trying to get a better performance on your learning. But then, of course, imagine that you have 100 images of this will be the short axis view of the heart, where you want to segment the inner layer of the heart. So you want to do segmentation on this. And you have this database, and you have your task, you have your performance measurement, and you are optimizing this into a learning algorithm. In the end, you will come, if you iterate until reaching the global minimum, you will have something like this, where of course this is very nice for this image. But then if you want to test the learning model that you learned with the optimization, if you want to test that with a validation set, so this new data that you don't know at all, then you will have a lot of error. So this image is explaining this a bit. You have a training set that you have a learning algorithm that is iterating to give you a very good performance on this training. But of course, if you keep on optimizing, you'll have a very low error for this training set. But whenever you have something new, you will have a very big error, which is the variance. So in the end, with the learning algorithm, you really need to find the balance or the trade-off between bias and variance. And there is when you have to stop, because you have something that is good enough for your training, but something that also generalizes to population that you don't know. And then which kind of data can we get from echo? Like for example, conventional diagnosis, they use scalar measurements like peak values, peak systolic values, peak diastolic, time to peak. But of course, echocardiographic protocols, they present a wealth of data. So for example, if you look at the views, you have the apical 2-chamber, 3-chamber, 4-chamber, 5-chamber view, you have the parasternal views, you have short axis and long axis, you have different modalities, as we've discussed this a lot, B mode, M mode, you have Doppler techniques that are giving you velocities and information derived from that. We have on B mode a way to track the tissue, which is speckle tracking and also can give you features. And in the end, you have not just scalar values, but you have the whole geometry, so you can have a mess of the geometry. You can have velocities, so you can have vectors of velocities in different parts of the heart. You also have a strain. This is an image from Mathieu. So in the end, you really have very different descriptors, and you want to integrate all of them into a learning algorithm. And of course, apart from the things that you can really go to the image, and in here, in the case of Doppler, for example, you can place a sample in different regions of your heart, and then you will see the velocity curves in these regions, and then you can export these traces into a TXT file that then you can analyze, because these are just numbers inside. Or if you do a speckle tracking, of course, you're tracking the tissue, and in the end, it's giving you a solution, so directly giving you the curves that you can export. But you can also, with more standard protocols, probably you don't have color Doppler or it's not available. So what we want to do also is, normally we have these kind of images. These are static images where you cannot extract, like, for example, with speckle tracking, you directly extract the curves. But here you have the image, and you, what you can do is also do a segmentation of the envelope just to get, in this case, this will be the mitral inflow, so the velocity of the blood coming to the ventricle, or the aortic outflow. So you can really do also segmentation on these images, and then if you have different cycles, you can average to get a more representative descriptor. So in the end, it's, you can, from these techniques, you can get data from images. You can also get actually patterns of hemodynamics and also the mechanical function of the heart. And in the end, you can use all these for your learning algorithms. Then about data normalization, of course, you get all this data, but you need to normalize it, because in the end, if you want to compare a population and you have the same descriptor for the whole population, you of course want to compare always systole with systole and diastole with diastole, and you don't want to mix. So you need in temporal alignment indeed, because of these reasons. So for example, imagine here this is a velocity trace in the basal septum of the left ventricle. So you will, from this kind of blood pool Doppler images, you have the aortic and the mitral flows. You can define where is the, first of all, you can define where is the beginning and the end of your cycle based on the ECG. And then based on these mitral and aortic flows, you can detect where is the opening of your valve, where is the closure. And using this timing, you can, in the end, put this on the curve of your subject and then time align all the phases. So in the end, you want to express all this into a common temporal reference. For a spatial alignment, the same, you will have a ventricle with where you predefine different regions, and you want your data to be expressed in these regions. So in the end, you can compare region-wise and temporal-wise. And then regarding now the analysis, so where to start actually, imagine that you have here this collection of, in here will be actually the flows of the aortic and the pulmonary outflows. So you will have two populations, a normal and Epstein's disease, and you have here the raw data. So what to do with this data? First, well, you have to look carefully at the data and see if you have already an intuition of what's going on there. But then what can we do? We can do just local analysis, so just look at the samples on your velocity trace, and then take like the median value, the quartiles, just to compare this normal with the disease population, see if there is something different there. Then the next step will be to see the most of variation in this data. So for example, using a principal component analysis, imagine this is a very easy example with just dots in a 2D space. With principal component analysis, you will get the maximum directions of variation. So this will be like the first mode. This will be the second mode. And this is a 2D example with points, with dots in a 2D space. But of course, the same applies for this kind of data. So in the end, you do a PCA on this data, and you can take the first mode, for example, and see what it encodes. In this case, the first mode on this data will be just amplitude, just for the aortic and pulmonary outflow. So you can now have more ideas of what is in your data, what is the variability that your data is encoding. And of course, in the end, you can also go back to the data and see if there is any outlier. For example, here, all the curves look very similar, but then there is a curve that is very different from the others. So you really have to go back to your images, for example, and see if this is a problem of your measurement or this is a real outlier. And in echo, some problems that you could see are, for example, rib artifacts in your image that are messing everything around. Or you can have a region out of plane, so you will then have data for this, or your data will be bad. Or you can have aliasing, and then the traces that you recover are not good. And then, of course, also with continuous variables, you can study the distribution of the variables, You can test whether there is or not correlation in your data. And of course, if you see correlation, probably if two variables are very correlated, probably you want to discard one of them because it's not going to give you any more information of your problem. And then with all this exploration, you can already have an idea or an intuition of the phenomenon that is captured by your data, and also an idea of which learning technique to use. And I'm going to comment on the learning technique to use a bit afterwards, but now I just want to show a couple of examples of PCA, where this is the same data set I was showing previously. So these were aortic and pulmonary outflows segmented from broad pool Doppler images. So this is an automatic segmentation where then after automatic segmentation you have to define where is the opening and the closure of the valve across different cycles. Then you get a representative descriptor, and then you put that and you want to compare your normal and your abstained population. So what I was doing here, it's just a PCA analysis on this feature and this other descriptor individually. And we were seeing that, for example, the first mode of this PCA analysis was discriminative of the abstains and the controls. So actually the abstains go towards -2 standard deviations of this mode. That will mean that they are over here, so their amplitudes are a bit lower. The controls, their amplitudes are towards two standard deviations, and their amplitudes are a bit higher. Then the second mode is also statistically significant, and it's telling you that the controls are towards -2 standard deviations, so it will be the blue curve here, and the abstains will be towards 2 standard deviations, which is your red curve here. So there is actually a difference in the peak velocity of the aortic outflow if you compare controls and abstains. And this is something that you can realize doing this kind of variability analysis and testing the differences between a population or the other. Then we didn't see any difference in the third mode, neither in the pulmonary outflow. So it was just the aortic outflow, which was giving you like significant differences across these two groups. Then another example, this is geometry extracted from 3D ultrasound, and this is comparing controls with fetal growth restriction, and it's just the same thing on this data, just doing an analysis of the main modes of variation, and they were finding that fetal growth restriction is different to controls in the size and also in the sphericity of the heart. So the FGR are more rounded, actually, the controls. And this is another example of what you can do with your data, just looking at the variability within your data, if you can see differences in two groups, for example. And now this is just taking your data and doing, let's say, an easy approach that is principal component analysis, but then you can go farther. And then one step farther could be more advanced learning and when to start when you want to do this more advanced learning. So of course you need to define first your category. So if it's going to be a supervised, in a supervised problem you normally have labels and you want your learning algorithm to learn these labels in the end to see a data and see if you can match the labels that you have. But of course you need to have labels that you trust, and the problem is that with many complex cardiac diseases, you cannot really trust in the diagnosis, for example, and then you couldn't use any label to train your algorithm because you want to, in a way, improve or see or explore your population, but not being based on a previous diagnosis that might be wrong. So in this case, supervised analysis couldn't be good, and then you will have to go for unsupervised analysis that it allows you to really do an exploration of what is in your data, and without being confused by labels, you can really identify different prevalent patterns in your population or different patterns identifying different groups and so on. And then as the application, you could have a classification where it's more like the management of an individual subject. So I have two groups that I already know where this subject lies in one group or the other. And you can use that for cancer detection or schizophrenia management or Alzheimer's disease. Also, you can have, in terms of application, representation learning. which is really revealing the low dimensional structure of your data, and it's more used for to measure the distance from normality. So if you have a pathology and you think that your pathology is a progression from normality towards a very advanced state of pathology, you can measure distances from normality, or you can see the progression of a disease over time in a longitudinal study, and evaluate whether or not there is an improvement with therapy. And we are more towards this, so we really want to see in especially in my PhD, we want to see data, complex data, we want to mix different things, and then take this representation of your population, this simplified representation, and test whether or not you can see things in this representation.
But Sergio, most of classification approaches, they anyway project everything to a low dimensional space, no? So I don't see.
Yes, indeed, but you are forcing, if you, so indeed, if you have supervised learning, you will force your clusters to be far away. If you don't use that, then of course you still can have a space where you can identify different groups. And this is indeed what we are doing. We have this description, like simplified description of a population, and then we can get a clustering algorithm learning on this space just to identify if we can see different groups. And in that way it will be kind of classification, but always keeping the notion of not a hard split, but always taking into account probabilities and how probably is that this subject is belonging to one category or another, and that way, yeah.
Yeah, I think this notion of going to a low dimensional space is indeed common and is quite important. The only thing is that depending on the methodology that you use, you will have explicit access to this low dimensional space, yes or no. If you use deep learning, you probably will never be able to reconstruct or explore that space. In other cases, you can. So I think the fact that the notion is there, that this is a really important step, I think is really important. And we have to see how we can use this much more.
And of course, going a bit farther away, and you can think, do I want a linear method? Do I want non-linear method? But if you think in the cardiac function, for example, these are just two examples of non-linearities in the heart. For example, where you are evaluating diastolic dysfunction, you know that there are different stages. So normal, and this is the flow through the mitral valve. So this first peak will be early diastole. So it's just the velocity when the mitral valve opens because of the gradients of pressure, there is blood coming in. And then the contribution of the atrial contraction to your flow. If you see a normal case, it could look like this. Then if you see, if you go to an earlier stage of diastolic dysfunction, the pattern will look like that. And then if you go to more advanced stages, the pattern will be like this. And of course, if you want to take a distance, a linear measurement of the distance of this to this, it will be less than this to that. And this is not logical, because you really have a population and you have a progression where your notion of similarities will be more here than if you compare these states with that state. And that's why you need nonlinear statistics. And then a simple example here in this three-dimensional space where you have dots in the shape of a Swiss roll here, and if you want to measure the distance of this point to this point and you take a linear measurement, you will take this straight line that is telling you that this two subjects are pretty close probably, but then if you take into account indeed your distribution, your progression, you will have to go from this point all the way up to this point. So then your distance will be much higher. And this is one thing we want to capture with our learning algorithms as well. So how to calculate the distance in this complex database? Well, in a way it's like trying to open this space into a flat surface that in the end allows you to do classical measurements, to do a classical distance approach. And in this way, so we are gonna use nonlinear dimensionality reduction techniques and indeed manifold learning. And I'm gonna explain now what manifold learning is. So a manifold is actually an n-dimensional space that locally resembles an Euclidean space. The most clear example will be the planet Earth, where if you you know that this is a three-dimensional space, but if you go really locally, you can represent this surface but a flat space. So we actually want to learn what is actually this low-dimensional representation of your manifold. And here there is just an example of why to also do nonlinear statistics. Apart from this example of the distances, for example, here with an image, if you think that your data is lying on this distribution, let's say, if you have an image here and an image there that are this and this one, and you want to do linear statistics, you will go to the straight line here, and you will say, oh, this point represents this image. While this image is not correct, because it's just a mix of this one and this one, and it's something that is not realistic indeed, because the guy is going with the hands from this place to this other place, and then this will be kind of a mixture between both positions. While if you go with nonlinear methods, you will really see the distribution of your data, and if you want to go to the middle point, you will really recover something that is meaningful. So something that is from this position to there is something in the middle indeed. And why do you want to apply manifold learning? Well, we were commenting a bit on that. It's just to do, you can use it for data compression. So in this case, if you have your planet Earth and you represent it in a 2D space, then you are getting rid of one dimension, so you are compressing. You are denoising because you can say that this third dimension is probably something that that is not interesting for you, so you are denoising. And of course, to do dimensionality reduction, and this is what we are interested in, and to get this low dimensional representation of your data. And also for visualization, if you get this distribution of your population, then you can see if a subject is there and probably he is normal, and the other is far away, you can really, really interpret what's going on in your population. And now how to do manifold learning. First, what you need to do is build a graph. And graph is just a representation of where you have nodes, and the nodes are just the samples in your population. And then you have edges that are actually pairwise similarities between your samples in the data. And then what you normally do is you do an eigen decomposition on the values of these graphs, and then you are getting a transformation matrix that allows you to project from this high-dimensional space to this low-dimensional space. And then, of course, the question is, do you want to do something that is global or that it's local? And I will explain this. And this is just an example of the manifold. So you will have here this distribution. You define, you have different samples on it, and you build this graph where you have nodes and you have edges that are telling you what is the similarity between one subject and the other. Then the first manifold learning technique that normally people think about, or the easiest one probably, is kernel PCA, where you really, it's an adaptation of principal component analysis, but instead of using linear metrics, you are going for nonlinear. So it's a reformulation of PCA, and instead working with a correlation matrix, you are working with a kernel that is defining the similarities in your data. And imagine that you have this data with three clusters. If you want to define similarities of one subject to all the others in your space, in the end you will come up with this matrix that indeed is telling you that there is one cluster here where the similarity of the subjects here is higher compared to the others, and then second cluster and a third cluster. And you'll think of this as a global technique because you are actually measuring globally the distances of one subject to all the others in your population. And this approach will be good for when you have data that is indeed clustered, and you can imagine here you have this population. With kernel PCA, you can really split your population into this group and this other group, while if you think in a linear technique, if you put on a straight line here or there or there or there, that's not going to work. That's not going to split your population. But if you do something non-linear, you can really put a straight line here and then split the reds and the blues. So this could be kernel PCA. Then isomap, which is another global manifold learning technique where what you do here is you define geodesic distances in your data set. And how do you define these geodesics? Is to build a graph like this, and you say, okay, the distance from this point to this point is gonna be the shortest path joining these two. So it will be this, and summing up all these similarities will give you in the end the geodesic distance, which is an overestimation of the real distance, but in this is a good approach.
One question, how could you project that on real patients? Because, okay, you can measure two patients, but to find the path between two patients, and you say that you go from patient to patient and you follow edges like that, it's just
generalizing from this three-dimensional simple space towards something that is more difficult. And that's why, for example, I have this space here, where instead having variables like profiles, velocity profiles or strain profiles, you have images. So you have a collection of images where you have faces looking at one way or another way or looking up and down. And then you take this collection of images and then you do isomap on these images and you get a two-dimensional representation. In the end, it's you have something complex, which is an image, and you are going towards a space which is two-dimensional and represents your population. It's giving you an idea of what's going on in your population. So forget now about the images here. Just concentrate on the two-dimensional space where each of these images will have a point that is the correspondent. So if you see actually this will be the learning in the set of images, if you look for a point here and you see, oh, this point here is represented by this image, you'll see that all the faces here will be looking to the left. All of them, all the faces here will be looking to the right. All the ones in the up will be looking up and down, looking down. So actually it's a way to, you have a set of images. There are many degrees of freedom in your image because as high as the number of pixels, but then you are simplifying these degrees of freedom towards a two-dimensional space that is really capturing this motion and the up and right, up and down motion. So that will also translate also to clinical descriptors. So you will have the normals, which probably will be represented here, the deceased, which will be represented in the other part of your simplified space. I don't know if that answered a bit your question. It's a bit difficult to get with
that. You are working in a lower dimension for those for the others. You already extracted some information that you use now. You're not working with the brute.
Normally, imagine in the case I work with color Doppler images. What I was doing for my PhD is not working with the whole image, but I was just looking at the deformation patterns or velocity patterns in different regions of the heart, like basal regions, mid regions. So. Then there is more algorithms to do this manifold learning. Locally linear embedding, I'm gonna be a bit fast on this because it's probably not very, very interesting. But locally linear embedding could be you have an input space,
Sorry, I have a really general question. Do you have any example of successful application of machine learning? Because I do not know. Does it work, for instance, for weather forecast or for which are the fields we are who's driving this technology?
I'm gonna show you later on an application for a cardiac problem where. I think we succeeded. I don't know, Alan, if you agree, we were really seeing differences in a population.
There is, for example, a publication later that can predict cardiovascular disease based on analyzing Twitter responses or Twitter contributions from people. So there's a lot of applications where you can do classification, and whether they're useful or not, that's something else. But the most common are the face recognition that you have in Facebook, or if you do Google search, similarity of images, that is all based on this kind of machine learning.
Yeah, every object recognition. So then another technique will be locally linear embedding where you have your input data and you define similarities in your input data, so you have a subject. You will see in your input data which are the closest ones, and then you are giving a weight in depending on the similarity of the subject to the neighboring ones. And then what you want to do in your low dimensional space is actually preserving these weights. So you don't care about anything else but preserving these weights, because this way you will preserve neighborhoods in your low-dimensional space. Another technique would be Laplacian eigenmaps, which could go to the more or less to the same approach. And this is, sorry,
I have a question about the graphs you build. Mm-hmm. Just a generic question on the technique. How do you restrict the number of edges? Because you you could basically link every nodes to every other nodes.
Yeah.
So is it based on the maximum distance between your samples?
Normally, what I'm, and this is part of, for example, a global technique like this one, wouldn't care about the number of neighbors. It will take all of them. If you do, if you go for a local technique, then you indeed you have to define the number of neighbors that you want to keep in your space to build this. So to build the graph, you need a number of neighbors. Normally, what I was doing is looking at, in the end, the low-dimensional space, looking at the variance of my data in this low-dimensional space, and I was selecting the number of neighbors that were maximizing this variance in my space.
So exactly,
because
like
I was presuming that by this, I was kind of unfolding this my space. So if you think in this curvy space, if you are maximizing the variance in your first dimensions, you are kind of flattened your population.
How is it like three dimensions?
Practically, these kind of algorithms will give you a number of dimensions, which is number of subjects minus one. So if you have 100 subjects, you have 99 dimensions. Indeed, it's already something, because if you have an image with 1 million pixels and you have 100 subjects, you will go from 1 million dimensions to 99. But in the end, these algorithms in the first dimensions, they are capturing the highest variability. And this highest variability is explaining better, is in the best way, your data indeed. So you will see that the first dimensions are the most relevant to explain what you want to explain. Then Laplacian eigenmap will be another technique where you also want to preserve, in the end, at close points in the input space. So if you are looking at distances between one image and another, or between one pattern and another, you want this distance to be preserved in the output space indeed. And this is based on this affinity matrix. So the affinities will be 1 if subjects are really close or identical, will be 0 if they are very far away. So in the end, you try to minimize this equation. And of course, if you have something for 2 subjects, so if you have a value for 2 subjects very similar, that is 1, and you want to minimize here, you want to make these output coordinates the same, just to minimize your problem. And then there are many manifold learning techniques, many nonlinear dimensionality reduction techniques, but in the end, which one to use, and that depends on your data set. And your data set, there is no magic on this, and you really have to know your data and what to apply. And for example, here, just an easy example of a Swiss roll, so it will be this three-dimensional space. If you want to reduce the dimensionality into a 2D space, with a PCA, you will mainly see this direction and this direction of variation, where this is not actually recovering your distribution, because your distribution will be opening up this space. While with isomap, for example, or Laplacian eigenmaps, you will be really opening this. So for example, isomap will work when we have uniformly sampled data, like here, there is a progression. And kernel PCA, as we are seeing here, it's working when you actually have clusters, where you have different, or in this case, it will recover these clusters. And then in the end, just as a summary of these techniques, in the end, they are all building a graph. They are doing same operations in this graph, and they are just changing the operator that you are using. In kernel PCA, it will be just a kernel matrix, which gives you similarities between your population. Isomap, as I said, it's taking into account the geodesic distance in your population, and so on. And in the end, there is a framework that is embedding all of them, that it's called graph embedding, that it's kind of unifying all this technique into the same thing. Now, a couple of examples in cardiac applications of manifold learning. For example, in this case, this is from my supervisor, Nicolas Duchateau. I think Matt was also involved in this work. So it's to measure distance from normality, and here they are looking at the strain patterns. So they will have time here and here the position along the left ventricle, and they will say, they will measure distance from normality. So imagine that this is normality, and if you go towards this line, you will go to more diseased profiles of deformation. And you build up your population, preserving these distances. And then if you have a new subject, you can take your algorithm, that the model that you learned to recover this distribution, and you can take a new subject, project it to your space, and see where is this subject in your population, if it is close to normality or it's close to the very diseased subjects. This is another application of MRI scans, where they were comparing normals with subjects with tetralogy of Fallot. Probably the clinical application, it's not very relevant, but indeed it allows me to explain, for example, if you have a set of images and you do this dimensionality reduction on these images and you recover this space, in the end you will see that the points along this first dimension, this first coordinate embedding, it's actually recovering this progression from most likely normal to most likely tetralogy of Fallot. And this, the nice thing of this is that it allows you not to do a hard split, but it allows you to think in terms of probabilities. So it's very normal, it's likely in the transition, so we don't really know, or it's very likely to have the disease. But now, until now, we were working just with one descriptor, one image, one deformation pattern. But what if we want to actually mix several descriptors? And this is indeed what they are doing in clinical practice. They are not just looking at one clinical measurement, but they are combining different things into a, for example, a decision tree, and in the end trying to get an output for your diagnosis for your patient. This is just an example we were doing for heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, where we had a population of normal subjects and diseased subjects. And we were actually testing which is the agreement of our learning algorithm with the real diagnosis. And we were seeing that in the way that we incorporate more information to our data, so if we just look, in this case we were measuring velocity curves in different regions of the heart and at different steps of exercise, we're seeing that just going to the septal velocity pattern at rest, it was not very good in the agreement with the clinical labels. And all the way you go down here, you add more information, and in the end you are improving the agreement. So the more data that you are looking at, probably the better it will be your output. But how to combine multiple patterns? Then the easiest thing will be to normalize features by the variability and then concatenate them. And this is a picture of my supervisor, of Nicolas Duchateau. I was not acknowledging here. But you will have, like in this case, a pear and an apple. If you do this concatenation, you will kind of mix them into something that it's not really probably useful, because the nature of the data is going to be different. Imagine if you have images, or you have velocities where they are vectors, and then you want to combine also a biomarker, like a scalar measurement. The nature is going to be different, so you are going to concatenate, but you are not going to respect this typology of your data. And then probably if there are redundancies, it's not worth to concatenate them, because if you have something redundant, it's probably gonna have this redundancy in your learning that you don't like. And if you use kernels, and kernels are this similarity matrix, so in a way what we do is we don't work with the features as they are, but we put a filter on our features and we define kernels. And in the end, kernels are telling us which is the similarity of this subject to the rest of your population. So you don't care anymore about the images or the patterns, but you just preserve these kernels that are notions of similarity for different descriptors on your data set. And this will be an analysis approach that we have for actually analyzing different descriptors. It was inspired by computer vision algorithm, where they were doing object recognition, and it was supervised. So they had an input, they had labels. Of, imagine you have different images, and you have an image of a chair, an image of a table, and you really want to look at these images and in the end get a representation where you can split tables from chairs. We were adapting this algorithm towards something that it's non-supervised, unsupervised because we don't have labels or we don't trust in the labels. In the case that you want to study a pathology, you probably you cannot rely on the diagnosis, so you cannot rely on the labels, and you don't want to incorporate this knowledge into your learning. So you just want to look at the data and see what is in there. And so this I explained a bit already. So we have features, in this case will be velocity profiles. For each velocity profile, we build this affinity matrix, which is telling you the affinity of one of subject one to all the others in your population, subject two to all the others. In the end, you are building these affinities, and then you are keeping from using all these affinity matrices. You are also building a graph of proximity. So you are defining to this subject, I just have these ones that are the closest, and in the end, I want to preserve these closest subjects in my output space. So in a way, it's the same as we were commenting before for manifold learning. In the end, I want the closest in my input data to remain close in my output space. And then a bit of formulation of this algorithm. It's based on the Laplacian eigenmaps approach. I was explaining this equation before. So this will be when you have just one data set that is XY. You define an affinity matrix according to similarities on this input, and in the end you will force this to be minimum, so you will force the output to be close if the affinity for the input data is very high. And then this, you can have different constraints for this equation. The unsupervised, which will be, of course you want to prevent the trivial solution, which will be all the points collapsing in zero, so their distance will be, of course, minimized, but you don't want this solution, so you put this constraint. Or if you have a supervised problem, you indeed incorporate another affinity matrix that is telling you actually what are your different classes in your data set. So what it will do is to put your output low-dimensional space, but taking into account which are the different classes in your data, if you want. And of course, the way to go from just one descriptor to multiple descriptors is taking these kernels I was commenting. And what the algorithm is doing actually is it's learning weights to give to these different kernels, and then a matrix that is projecting from your input space to your output space. So this will be the unknowns in your problem. You have this, which is this global affinity matrix, and you have the kernels that you were defining for every feature.
Could you just re-explain how do you define the two constraints exactly? If you can go through the different terms, and maybe how it is implemented in the problem, like.
I was actually focusing in this one. If you have this one, you have here a similarity graph where it's just accounting for neighbors, also for class. So if you have class one and you have three neighbors, but there are three neighbors, two of them are class one and one is class two, you are not gonna integrate that in your similarity matrix. So in the end, you are gonna split your population in your different classes because you are not going to minimize the distance of a subject with the subject of another cluster or another class. And in a way, this, in the unsupervised way, you are actually preserving the variance of your data. So the first dimension has this variance, second dimension has this other variance, and you want to preserve that, and you don't want all your points to collapse in the same point. So you are really preserving this variability in your...
What is the D in the equation?
The D here will be, if you sum this similarity matrix, you are summing up row-wise. So in the end, you will have a diagonal matrix where you have this weight.
And in practice, this is like added as another term to the cost function?
In practice, what?
You add this constraint to the cost function with a lambda?
I add this term to this minimization problem. So it's the only constraint. And of course, well, we also have another constraint that is forcing all the weights to be one. But we, of course, have to discuss this, and I will comment that in the limitations, because with the weights, sometimes depending on the type of data, you can have the optimization can mess everything around, and we have to find what's the solution. But in this case, in the case that you have for example, strain patterns or velocity curves, and they are the same topology of data, you won't have so much problems with that.
Sorry, one question. The kernel ki, is it for the feature I or for the sample I?
This kernel, you mean?
Yeah, that kernel matrix, because you say that.
When this kernel matrix is composed by the similarities of subject one to all the others for feature one, feature two, feature three. So okay. It wouldn't be a kernel for one feature, but it would be the similarity of subject one to all the others regarding all the features.
But then you have to weight the features.
Yeah, you
inside.
You are weighting them here with this.
Now, when you do exponential x minus y divided by sigma.
We are normalizing these ones, just to take into account.
Okay, so you suppose that all the features have the same weight inside K. That's what you mean.
So all the K's have been normalized, and then the weight that you learn, it's within your optimization. So you are not giving a weight for building the kernel, but you are just normalizing your features in terms of variability, so you don't want a feature that is very variable to.
But sometimes maybe one feature could be more important and much more could be, I mean, significant. It has a significance for a pathology or.
Yeah. So in this case, imagine that you have a feature, because this is in a way what you want to preserve, and you imagine that subjects that are similar in your input. We have the same pathology. So even you don't care if the feature is very variable or not. But if this feature is not that much variable, but you still assume that your closest are gonna be of the same category. So you don't really care if the variability, because in the end everything will be weighted inside the algorithm. So you don't really have to give a prior weight to which one has the highest variability. Because it doesn't matter of the variability, but you assume that the neighbors will be of the same class, so you don't really care about that. And this is just about optimization of the problem. First, you want to optimize the projection matrix and the weights in a two-step iterative approach until you find the minimum value for this solution. And then in the end, so you have this algorithm in the end is taking complex data, many different descriptors, and in the end you get a space that is low dimensional. In this case we are just taking the first three dimensions of the space, and we have 1,000 subjects here. But what do we do with this? I mean, this looks like a cloud of points. How do we interpret it, and how can we do with this to help clinical diagnosis or to help in gaining knowledge about a cardiac disease? And so in the end, this is a collaboration with Alan Fraser in a project, a European project that is MEDIA. I will acknowledge them afterwards. But so they were studying heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. And the population that we had was first of all, a bit of a clinical description of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. It's a syndrome that presents signs of heart failure, but a normal EF. There is a predominance of diastolic dysfunction. Probably this is a very brief summary, Alan, if you want to comment on that. But it's very heterogeneous condition where you have really different pathophysiological subtypes. So there are many disease processes contributing to this syndrome in the end. And its diagnosis, of course, is difficult because there are so many things going on. And so many different kinds of that it's in the end difficult to make an exact diagnosis, and the ideal approach will be to in a way learn this heterogeneity if the syndrome is because of one reason or the other, and then we can learn these different etiologies and then in the end give a better treatment that it's more adapted to each of the groups. The population here was a multicenter study. We had 72 HFpAF subjects diagnosed by the guidelines. We had 33, this is not really right, it's not age match, but it's like more or less same age. Healthy controls, 24 hypertensives and 27 breathless subjects. And we had this data, septal and lateral velocities on the LV, So on this myocardial velocity imaging modality, we were placing samples here and there and actually getting the velocity curves, and we were measuring this at rest and submaximal exercise. Why exercise? Because indeed, what we assume is that the half-path subjects are going to behave differently at exercise, but probably at rest, their differences are not going to be that much compared to controls. And then why to mix two populations that are normals and half-paths then with two other classes? So indeed, these were controls also in the study, but they have something. They are not really healthy, but they have something else. And we assume that this pathology is a progression from normality towards disease. Probably these ones are in the middle, so in this gray zone, that we don't really know what's going on, and we can probably, with this kind of algorithms, we can give a better idea of where these two groups are lying compared to normality or disease. And so what are my objectives with this data? Is it classification? It's not really classification because we don't want to do this hard split, but it's more like characterizing the variability, really learning what's the distribution of on the population. Do I have labels? Yes, indeed, I have labels. I have controls, half-paths, hypertensives, but do I trust them? And indeed, if we want to do is improve a bit the diagnosis of this syndrome, we don't want to rely on the diagnosis. We just want to learn from the data. So we are not going to involve labels, and we are going to use an unsupervised learning algorithm, as I was explaining before with all these equations. And now, again, going to preprocessing of data, you will first, if you are going to compare velocity curves in a population, you first need to time align them. So you need systole to match temporally with systole, you need diastole to match temporally with diastole, and you do this timing based on the flows on the mitral and the aortic valve. And this will be our input data, which is velocity curves at rest and submaximal and at different regions of the heart. And what we do is we don't take the whole pattern as a whole, but we analyze different cardiac phases separately, because in this way we are better to see whether or not there is something pathological in one phase or the other, while if we put the whole thing, we are probably be putting noise into the. So we are making things easier if we are splitting our data in different phases, because then we'll see if there is something pathological in systole or diastole or late filling or whatever. And of course, we were time aligning this, but the timing in your population might have any impact on the result. So probably it has information indeed. And it's actually being shown that pathologic subjects might have different timings compared to controls. So when we do this time alignment, we are losing this information, but we want to actually preserve what's the information we were losing with this temporal alignment. And we were putting that into our learning algorithm. And this is an example of the output that we had. If we don't put this temporal information, or we put it, so here in orange will be not including the timing information, in green including it, just for a set of experiments. And we always saw that putting the timing, if we want to match our output with the clinical diagnosis, we were always better putting the timing than not putting it. So it's indeed giving you information about what's going on there. So we decided to keep the temporal information. And this is a bit of a pipeline that we were using to characterize this population of half-paths compared to controls. So we had the input. We were quantifying similarities and reducing the dimensionality of our data with this multiple kernel, with this algorithm that I was showing before. By the way, it's called multiple kernel learning algorithm that I didn't mention the name. But in the end, it gives us this output representation, which is low dimensional and where you can better interpret your population. And we were, with this, we were trying to train a clustering algorithm that was recognizing different populations in your output. So just based on the densities of your points in your output, you are coming up with different clusters. And then we were checking, are these clusters meaningful or not? Do they have any clinical meaning? Are they useful in any way for diagnosis? And this is what we were checking. So we were comparing the clusters, just looking at the clinical variables for cluster one, cluster two. Then we were doing this analysis of variability, so really seeing what's the fingerprint of cluster one and cluster two. So we are going from this input-output space all the way down to the input space. And with regression techniques, we are recovering what's the variability in our input data. So what cluster one means, cluster two means. And then with these clusters, we were computing distances to cluster one and cluster two. And indeed, we were seeing afterwards, when we had this 2D map with distances of each subject to one cluster or the other, we were comparing this to the clinical labels, to healthies and half-paths, and we were seeing that we had a region with most likely healthies, most likely half-paths, but then this transition that was the progression indeed from healthy to half-path, and it's this gray zone where most of our, let's say, the clinical diagnosis didn't agree with our learning. So what we were saying with these clusters did not agree with the clinical labels, and this is this transition zone. And in the end, we were taking this and analyzing what we learned here, putting new cases that will be these hypertensive and breathless subjects to see where these groups are lying on this space that we learned, just with controls and half-paths. So this is just an illustration of what we get. This could be the output space just in two dimensions. This is the output of our clustering algorithm that is recognizing one and two clusters. And then if we compare this that we learned indeed with the clinical labels, we saw that there was actually quite a lot of agreement. And then, of course, if we want to interpret the clusters, first thing that we do is going to the clinical variables that most of them were used for clinical diagnosis of normality versus half-path. And we were comparing cluster one with cluster two and seeing whether or not this will be the p-value. And this is from you, Alan. I was getting this slide from you. But the table is mine, but the but the comments are from Alan. So we were getting different statistically significance in AIDS, in body mass index, 6-minute walk test, in the peptide levels, E over prime ratio at rest, and LV max index for cluster one and cluster two. So these differences were actually also matching the clinical diagnosis. So most of them, which are different in cluster one and cluster two, are the variables that you are using for clinical diagnosis. So actually, your cluster one and cluster two are making sense from a clinical point of view. And then how to explain the clusters, how to come up with this fingerprint of the cluster. So imagine that you have your low dimensional data and you have this ellipsoid, which is your data set. If you want to recover the main modes of variability of this data, you will go to the coordinates of your point in your output space and you will see that this is the first main mode of variability, so the first where you have the highest variability, then second mode, and then the third mode will be in the z-axis. And then what we were doing is going along these modes that we were learning in our population and taking subjects that are in minus two to two standard deviations. So these are subjects that in the end, using regression, we are reconstructing. So this is kind of a synthetic subject. It's not real, it's not in your population, but you want to see how it looks like. And you will look at the features of the neighboring subjects and you will reconstruct the input data for this subject. So you will do this for different modes, and this is the way you are actually recovering what's in your cluster, what your clusters are explaining. And then this is just a figure of cluster one compared to cluster two. So cluster one will be what we assume that from the previous table comparing clinical variables, that the one we assume that are the healthy subjects, and the cluster two, the ones that we assume that they are the half-paths. And we are seeing here first mode and the second mode of variation for cluster one and for cluster two. And here this will be the first and the second mode, so the main modes of variability in your data, let's say, and then comparing different features. So actually septal velocities at rest and septal and lateral velocities at rest and septal and lateral velocities at exercise. This is probably a bit difficult to interpret, but mainly what we see is that cluster one, its amplitude is a bit higher compared to cluster two. Then, for example, especially at exercise, you will see that in diastole there is more fusion in the disease cluster compared to the normal cluster. But then this is again a bit difficult to interpret, and this is just visual assessment. But what you can do is really go to the traces and put this into numbers. So really, what is the overall amplitude for one lung cluster and the other, and take numbers and color code these numbers and see, and coming up with this representation where you compare one cluster to the other. So you will see that for overall amplitude, the healthy cluster is higher. The color map is here, so this will be minimum value, maximum value. So overall amplitude is higher in the healthy cluster compared to the disease cluster. Diastolic fusion, there is more in the disease cluster. Then there is a bit more of systolic delay in the lateral exercise of the healthy cluster. And then you can come up with different things. Which is also very important is that you can learn things from this that probably were not known in clinical practice. For example, atrial delay, we're seeing with our course that indeed this second peak at diastole in the cluster of the half puffs that we learned, it's actually not time aligned, so there is an offset in this peak, while in the cluster one you don't see it that much. So indeed you will see here more red colors than in cluster one, and this atrial delay is actually different in the half puffs. There is more atrial delay, which has been recently also published as probably a marker of or heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Then this will be the representation where we learn with our clusters, and we see individual distances to cluster one and cluster two, and then on top of that we put the clinical label, so healthy or half puff, and we were seeing that this is the healthy and the half puff regions, and then this transition zone, which was the one maximizing the number of discrepant cases, so indeed the ones where the clinical diagnosis said one thing and the learning algorithm was saying the other thing, and minimizing the number of well-classified subjects. And we, of course, wanted to check if this is of any meaning or not, and that's why Bart and Alan, in a blind way, were going back to the echocardiographic records of different subjects on our population, especially all of the ones that are here with a green cross, which were the misdiagnosed cases, but also some of the really diseased and the really healthy subjects. All this in a blind way, and they were going back to the echo of the echo studies of these subjects. And in the end, they came up with the description of that the discrepant healthy group, so the ones that are lying in this part that were healthy for in the clinical diagnosis, they had hypertensive heart disease and other anomalies like hypertrophy, right ventricular diastolic dysfunction, impaired functional reserve, and interatrial delay. And the discrepant half-puffs, so the ones that are half-puffs but are lying on the other side of this frontier, they were not, let's say, in this population, most of the half-puffs were hypertensive half-puffs, but these ones were not the clear hypertensive half-puffs. And some of them were presenting conduction-related dysfunction or hypertrophic cardiomyopathies. So they were not really the type of half-puff subject that we had in the population.
One question. Is there a threshold that you apply to separate them? Or you have already, the healthy patient, healthy region, and the other are labeled from...
So to build the 2D graph, we don't use any label. But then on these distances, to group one and group two, then we compare them with the clinical diagnosis. And then we see the black dots are the ones that were properly classified with our algorithm compared to clinical labels. And then the greens are the ones where our algorithm was not matching the clinical diagnosis. So we had this 2D graph, and in this, in this 2D graph, we were superimposing the clinical diagnosis mm-hmm. and highlighting which were the ones that were misclassified.
But the algorithm, when he classifies, he don't know if it is healthy or
of
not.
Of course, I mean it is totally unsupervised, it's blinded. Yes. So it comes, so it looks at the population, at the data that you are looking at, it comes up with this distribution, and then you put a clustering algorithm that is not based on the labels, it's just based on the location of the subjects in your space. And then this will be your clusters, and then you compare these clusters with the clinical diagnosis. Diseased, yes or not?
Regarding the clustering part at the end, one problem of unsupervised is choosing the number of clusters. So here you say I have two clusters, maybe you have three in your data. Mm-hmm. Do you have an automatic way to reduce?
This is one thing that we, for this, we were not doing that. We were coming up with two clusters because we thought that it was the, from the clinical point of view, probably the easiest, probably not the most interesting, because if we go with more clusters, probably, as we said, there are different etiologies of HFpAF. Probably we could be able to differentiate these different groups. But for these results, we were just taking two clusters and assuming that one is healthy and the other is diseased. Now, for other data, what we are doing is we can do different clusters. What we do is normally we take what is called the mean silhouette value, that it's giving you an idea of how good your cluster configuration is regarding to minimize the intra-cluster variance. You want the clusters to have high density, but you also want to maximize the distance between clusters. So you can try with different configurations of clusters. Of course, you can also, because as I said, the output space that we get is low dimensional, but how many dimensions to keep? Because you have, if you have 100 subjects, you have 99. Probably from the 10 on, it's going to be rubbish. It's something that is not going to explain anything in your data. So you are also taking different number of dimensions in your output space, different number of clusters that you come up with. But then you look at the value of this mean silhouette value, which is telling you the density of the clusters and how separated are they. And then you will get this configuration of the most likely in your data as the best configuration indeed. Then we were, as I was saying, I was interpreting all the time the clusters that we found, but then we can extend these to other groups, and indeed they were not part of the learning that we used for this. So we have the learning model, and then we have the data for these hypertensives and the breathless. So we take their data and we project this data to the space that we learned previously. I have to say that they are lying, all the hypertensives, or most of them in the transition or the HFpAF region, the breathless subjects, most of them lying also in the transition and the HFpAF, more towards the HFpAF. But if you look at the dimension, of the numbers, they are from until 0.3 distance to the cluster one, while in this representation of the HFpAFs, they are going all the way up to one. So indeed, our hypertensives and our breathless could be like in this region, while the really HFpAF ones are very far away from the healthy group. And indeed, we were doing the same thing also in a blind way, going back to the echocardiographic records of the hypertensive and the breathless. And we're seeing that, well, actually, if we try to correlate the position of the hypertensives, so the distance to cluster one to the healthy subject, with the degree of hypertension, we're seeing that there was quite a nice correlation of the hypertension level with the distance to this cluster one. And the breathless subjects, we were going in detail to these studies, and we saw that those in the transition zone, and they don't have no definite abnormality or they have hypertensive heart disease, while the ones lying in the HFpAF region here, they have something probably a bit more, higher anomaly. And this is this is the acknowledgments of the people in the project. So this was part of the media project, people from Cardiff University of Oslo, so Cardiff University's Alan Fraser and colleagues, University of Oslo, Perugia, Novara, and then we as external collaborators were taking this data and analyzing it. But then, just to mention other works using MKL, so multiple kernel learning, what I was using to do all this work. There is some guys in KCL that are trying to give prediction of response to CRT therapy based on different data, so in geometry, and then different descriptors, like I think it was strain rate, displacement, and velocity profiles in a population. And then they were coming up with the kernels, and then they were summing up other things that are clinical, so clinical variables, electrocardiograms. They were taking measurements from echo, like ejection fraction, E over prime, E over A, and different descriptors from ultrasound. And in the end, they were coming up with an output where they wanted to evaluate whether or not they could predict the response to CRT. And this is just a figure of the weights. It's quite interesting that they have non-responders and responders to CRT, and they have super responders. So they have these three categories. When they want to do the split from super response versus non-response and response, they were seeing that the QRS width is important, and also the LVVV pattern, whether or not there is LVVV. Then the motion descriptors, they were seeing that velocities and strain rates were important. And when they were comparing all that, they were just in the end seeing that these motion descriptors have a value of zero, and LVVV and QRS width, which are the scalar values, are predominating. This is a problem that we have with MKL as well, that normally if we put some categorical variables or some scalar measurements are probably dominating in our learning. We have to explore more about this, but they were getting similar results. And then also, if you want to split non-responders versus response and super response, they were detecting other things, other importances in their data. And then in terms of agreement or in terms of prediction, they were predicting, so they were recommending the CRT therapy to all the subjects that were going to respond. So the ones who were delivered the CRT were responding, and the ones that they, and then the specificity is a bit lower, because they were not, they were sparing the treatments, no, sorry, they were giving the treatment also to subjects that are not gonna work. So still this is in the same numbers that they have in the literature for response to CRT therapy. So still it's very complicated, and they are not there yet with this complex analysis of geometry and cardiac function mixed with other parameters. But it's a very nice attempt. And then this is also work where they had a population where they want to see the response to stress over time. So they had different cycles so they were measuring subjects at different point. Well, not at different points. It was actually a continuous measurement, and they had rest, and then at some point they were putting stress on the subjects, and they wanted to see if this response to stress is different in different groups, and if they can see differences or not. They were working with global strain curves. This is a work that was submitted to FIMH, so that's why I'm not saying names or anything, because it's supposed to be anonymous. But they have global strain curves and they have heart rates, so they are combining both of these descriptors. And in the end, what they are coming up is with a simplified space where they see the trajectory of, so they have one subject with 60 cycles, and they want to see which is the trajectory of this subject and all his 60 cycles in the output. And they were seeing actually differences between normal response to exercise, and also if there is an abnormal response to exercise characterized by post-systolic motion or post-systolic plus delayed atrial contraction. So this is also a very nice approach to see how we can measure and take different descriptors and how we can integrate them to get a distribution of the data and see if this distribution is useful to see the different things, in this case, different patterns of response to exercise. But then some open questions regarding this kind of algorithms is how to deal with scalar, continuous, dichotomous, and categorical variables, because when you put them in the learning algorithm, they are messing everything a bit. So you have to take care about that. And then so far, using kernels, we were just doing a linear combination of the kernels, and so a weighted addition. But we should probably go to something which is more a bit better, so more probably non-linear combination of kernels. Different types of kernels. So we were so far using just Gaussian kernels, but there are many types of kernels that we can study, and there are indeed different. When you work with kernels, you define a bandwidth that is kind of your filter in your population that it says, just give me a number of similarity of this subject to the others, but then I have this, let's say, cutoff, where from that on, you don't consider him a neighbor at all. So you can really vary this cutoff, and you can try different kernels, and probably have different kernels varying this cutoff, and that can give you a better idea of what's the distribution of your population. And then how to choose these parameters is also very important. And now facing the reality, of course, when you have a clinical data set and you are working with different measurements, probably some of them are gonna be missing, while to do this kind of MKL algorithms, we need all the data because we need to define similarities for every feature, but then we need the data for every subject. So what do we do? How do we deal with that? Classical imputation methods are, if you have something that is missing, you just give a zero value, or you just take the average of the population and you give the mean value, or you do regression on your population and you say, I'm gonna take the closest subjects and I'm gonna impute my data according to these closest subjects and what we know about them. And this is an example from Madi Tavashian. Is he at Leuven now? Or not anymore?
He was at Leuven.
Madi Tavashian, he is.
Post-doc
at Leuven. Okay. So he was taking different strain curves in different segments of the LV. And then he had his population, but he had some segments that were missing. So what he was doing was concatenating the information. So in this case, working with strain patterns for every segment, he was concatenating every segment and then defining proximities to his data set, comparing distances, in this case, linear distances from this subject to all the others. So he was taking the closest, and then he was using the information of the closest subjects to impute what is missing indeed here. Then he was taking a weighted average of the neighbors and then imputing the data that was missing. And this will be an example of the original data and what they were imputing. This has probably some limitations because what you are doing is concatenating different features. You don't care that much if you're about the variability of your feature to define these neighborhoods. So I'll say that you really need to go independently feature by feature, because some features are going to have high variance and they are going to contribute more in your neighborhood decision than others, and you should take that into account. Now as I was explaining,
Maybe just one question about the missing data. So you say about imputation, some kind of extrapolation. Would it be also interesting to have an understanding of why are these data missing? Because most of the time, it's due to, technical difficulty during the exam, or, there are many reasons why these data are missing, and I guess most of the time there are some clinical significance for
us. Yeah, absolutely. So actually, this is one of my next slides. Like, probably the data is missing for a reason, and you don't really need to imputate, but you need to cope with that in a way, and you have to use this as information for your learning, indeed. So it's gonna probably have some value, this information. But yeah. How long are we now? How many minutes do I have left?
Yeah, we are about to finish, I think. In case you are wondering, Sergio is a semi-marathon runner, and he's doing 1 hour 40 for the semi-marathon.
It's 1 hour 40 now.
I'm saying you have a lot of resistance and endurance, maybe more than the audience.
So, well, this is just some different approaches that we were using for imputation of data. If we are working with kernels, we don't really need to go and imputate the real data, but just the kernels, because they are defining the similarities, and you have far fewer missing entries in this similarity matrix than in the real profiles that you want to imputate. So we were doing this kind of using also regression techniques, but not to imputate actually the input data, but just the kernels. I'm gonna go fast now. And now facing reality as well, if you have multi-center studies, what you do there, you have, of course, inter-observer variability, and there is probably lack of standardization. Different centers did not acquire the same thing, and of course, you'll have missing data. Imagine in a very big clinical trial, probably some hospitals are gonna have the technology, some others are not gonna have it, so probably they are not gonna acquire the same thing, and you'll have missing data. And also, if you have data coming from different vendors, and this is a problem that I was facing because I was using these images just to automatically segment things on the images, and then depending on the vendor, you have, for example, the ECG there, or you have it here, and then some things are changing, so you really need to face these kind of things. But then a key condition for machine learning to work well is that you need a large number of samples to learn, which is not normally the case in clinical data. So the more complex that you go, the more features that you introduce, the more data that you need to learn, and the better the, of course, with more data, the better the generalization ability of your learning. So actually our new research perspectives are to test our learning algorithms or very large clinical trials, and that's why I'm going to Boston in a month, because they have such a large clinical trials that we can do learning on that. And I'm finishing now, preliminary results with some of these large clinical trials where we had 1,000 patients, heart failure patients, who were randomized to have CRT or not. And we were analyzing the strain traces at 49 LV locations. So in the end, we had all this data, these 49 strain traces across many regions in the heart. And then we were coming up with this output space using our clustering techniques just to come up with different clusters. And then this is a bit the comparison of the clusters by clinical variables. And virtually all of the variables were different between clusters: age, gender, NIHA class, QRX width, ejection fraction, whether or not there was ischemia, myocardial infarction, the pressures, LVVV pattern. So almost everything was indeed different. And then just an interpretation of the clusters. So now this is the fingerprint of the cluster. So now we have the strain map here. Here is time, and here is the position along the LV. And this will be mode one. And these are actually just traces that we were taking from the map. So this will be the septum, the apex, and the lateral wall traces. Then this will be for cluster one, which was indeed the healthiest group across this heart failure population. They have the highest EF, most narrow QRS. I'm not going to go through detail into this, but that it was quite clinically relevant, the clusters that we were learning. And these are the other clusters. I'm not going to go into detail, but just to give you the idea that if we learn on this data with such an algorithm, we can really learn the distribution in our population, recover different clusters, and see whether or not they are meaningful. And now, well, just I couldn't finish without talking about deep learning. Deep learning is now everywhere for segmentation, volume estimation, segmentation again for diagnosis. But I think we have to be careful, because it's okay, deep learning as an unsupervised model, to learn robust feature on your data that you can then later on train into a supervised or an unsupervised model to have an idea of your population, but it still is a black box, and also by experience with clinicians, they don't like a black box. They want to know what is in there. They want to know if you recover a population, what was more meaningful to get this distribution, what was impacting more your distribution, your population, the different clusters, how can you explain them, how can you see if they are different or not, how can you get their fingerprints. So I guess for deep learning, they are trying to mathematically explain what is in there and how it's working, but they are not there yet. So I would say for clinical diagnosis, it's still of, I would say, limited value. Of course, for segmentation or other tasks, it's probably nice, but for to give a real diagnosis and something that you can trust, is probably we are not there yet. And then just as a summary, a general recipe for analysis is that you have to really look at the data, then perform probably some easy statistics on it, principal component analysis, see if you have any outlier, if you have to go to a nonlinear algorithm, if you want to use one descriptor or many descriptors to characterize your population, and then of course, in the interpretation, how do you want to interpret that? I give a couple of examples with applications that we were doing, but this is one of the most important parts. How do you interpret what you learned? And then just as a conclusion, machine learning is of course a very powerful tool because you can integrate lots of data in a fast, objective and very reproducible manner. You have to study your data and your problem just to define the application and how is it going to be set. Machine learning is not a master key. It doesn't solve everything. It's not magic, or the machine doesn't have a brain by itself. And we still have a long way to go in clinical practice, still in terms of interpretation and validation. And that's a bit all. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Innovation and you. Philips.